Apis mellifera, the western honeybee, has a remarkable ability to thermoregulate its colony. And this ability to thermoregulate has allowed Apis mellifera to have a natural distribution that goes from parts of Northern Europe through the Middle East all the way down to the southern tip of Africa. And so if you think about that, that's really amazing because that's a huge climate variation from one place in its northernmost range to one place in its southernmost range. And think about all of the climates and the environments that that one species of honeybee lives in all the parts of Europe, in all the parts of the Middle East, and in all the parts of Africa. And a lot of that was made possible because they can thermoregulate. Much of what we know about honeybee thermoregulation capacity comes from research on colonies maintained in managed hives, hive styles and hive types that you would see around the world, which are often made of wood, typically thin-walled. And the reason I point this out is in their natural environment, bees are nesting in thick-walled tree cavities or in the ground or places that have a lot of protection from the elements that they may not necessarily get when they're in the managed hives that we use. And as a result, a lot of these responses, be it cooling the nest or heating the nest, might be responses to the cavities that we put them in rather than the cavities they would choose on their own. So I wanted to share that with you because I'm going to be discussing this as if these behaviors are behaviors that bees would use anyway, when it's very possible that these behaviors are altered to match the environment in which we place the colonies rather than the environment in which they would choose on their own. Honeybees can detect changes in temperature as small as a quarter of a degree Celsius. That's almost half a degree Fahrenheit. And honeybees prefer for their colony to be in a range of somewhere in the neighborhood of 33 to 36 degrees Celsius, which is somewhere in the neighborhood of about 91 to about 97 degrees Fahrenheit. So they like that temperature range in their colony. It optimizes brood production, it optimizes bee ability to fly and movement and behavior. But they are able to maintain that tight range even when an ambient temperature is minus 40 Celsius all the way up to plus 40 Celsius, which is minus 40 Fahrenheit up to 104 Fahrenheit. So despite all of these environmental temperatures that honeybees encounter, they can keep their core nest temperature, that core temperature in the midst of the colony, exactly what they need it to be to optimize the colony function, brood survival, bee health, etc. So in this video, I'm going to tell you how they do that. We could start from the top and ask, why do bees keep colonies warm rather than keep colonies cool? You know, somewhere in that neighborhood of 90 to 95 degrees Fahrenheit is actually quite warm, right? We don't like that. When we go into our houses, we bump the air conditioner down to try to keep it much lower than that. Well, what happens is that honeybees optimize brood rearing conditions somewhere in the neighborhood of about 90 to 95 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's where brood is optimally produced. If it's lower than that, then brood development is much slower. If it's higher than that, then you could actually have increased brood mortality. Furthermore, bees can't fly at temperatures below about 54 degrees Fahrenheit. So below that temperature, they're just simply unable to leave the nest. That means if it's too cold, they can't defend the nest, they can't forage, they can't do any number of tasks or activities or behaviors that are necessary for the function of that colony. So honeybees like to raise that temperature in the colony when brood is present to be somewhere in that 90 to 95 degree Fahrenheit or 32 to 35 degree Celsius temperature window to optimize brood rearing. Now, when there's no brood present in the nest, the bees will actually let the nest temperature decrease significantly. It can be somewhere in the neighborhood of 60 to maybe 70 degrees Fahrenheit. So it's not necessary to maintain that core temperature for life, but rather brood production. So as amazing as honeybees sound, their ability to thermoregulate, their ability to cool the nest when they need to or warm the cluster when they need to, they still have a lot of wiggle room within these ranges that they try to maintain the temperature of the colony, you know, depending on what it is they're trying to accomplish in the nest. So there are multiple ways that bees try to thermoregulate their nest. They do this both actively and passively. So I'm going to talk about the passive strategies first. Bees use the physical nest structure itself in passive thermoregulation, the thickness of the walls, where the nest is off the ground or in the ground, the size of the entrance, as well as the volume of the cavity itself and all the insulatory materials of the pollen and the honey and the wax and the propolis, etc. But bees also have to actively regulate the temperature within that nest, specifically in the brood area. And this has to happen when it's too cold outside and the bees need to heat the nest, or if it's too hot outside and the bees need to cool the nest. So let me break this thermoregulation down into really two parts: what bees do when they're heating that area of the nest that needs to be heated, and what bees do when they're cooling that area of the nest when that area of the nest needs to be cooled. So at temperatures below about 60 degrees Fahrenheit, that's about 15 degrees Celsius, the bees will begin clustering. So let's think about what that means. Cluster, there's a lot of information in that name. We know that word clustering means coming together. So imagine then a hive that has multiple combs, and you've got thousands of bees in that hive. So those combs have spaces or gaps between them, but those combs also have empty cells in them. So bees will actually go into those empty cells and between the combs to essentially make an almost contiguous body of bees interspersed amongst the wax, the pollen, the honey, etc. So when bees cluster, they're forming this tight ball of bees. And in the middle of that cluster, we have what we call the core bees. And on the edge of that cluster, we have what's called the mantle bees. And those core bees, the ones in the cluster, will actually shiver their flight muscles to generate heat. And when enough of the bees are doing this, you get this core temperature within that cluster that's accomplishing whatever it is the bees need to do. Remarkably, individual bees, adult bees that are very warm, can crouch over capped brood cells so that their thoraces transfer heat to that brood cell, back to that structure of the cluster. You've got those core bees and you've got the mantle bees. Well, the mantle bees can become so cool on the edge of that mantle that they are too cool to move. They've become too chilled to move. They can enter a chill coma. And so what you get is, if you look at this cluster of bees, you get regular cycling of core bees to the mantle and mantle bees to the core to ensure that the bees on the outer edge are not chilling or freezing to death. Now remember, the core temperature of that nest, the needs of that core temperature vary significantly based on whether brood is being reared or not. So if there's no brood, you can actually get core temperature fluctuations by 20 degrees Celsius or 36 degrees Fahrenheit. That means throughout the day, that core might be 20 degrees Celsius difference depending on what those needs are. A colony with brood will maintain a core temperature of about 34 degrees Celsius, which is 94 degrees Fahrenheit, while one without brood will maintain that core temperature of about 18 degrees Celsius, which is 64 degrees Fahrenheit. In these cases, the bees on the outside of that cluster are reaching much cooler temperatures. They can reach temperatures in the neighborhood of 10 degrees Celsius or 50 degrees Fahrenheit. So the core is not just heating the bees in the middle of that cluster, but it's also radiating out to get those bees on the outside of the cluster. But what happens when they need to keep the nest cool? Remember, if that nest temperature exceeds somewhere in the neighborhood of about 104 degrees Fahrenheit, that's 40 degrees Celsius. The nest is really starting to get hot. Brood rearing is not optimized, and you can get some things like beeswax softening and collapse. So what do they do? Well, what they do is actually quite remarkable. Bees will forage for water, collect water, return to the nest, and sprinkle droplets of water throughout the nest. Then they stand at the nest entrance or on the walls of the box and fan their wings. The ones that are on the walls of the box, when they fan their wings, they're circulating air within the nest. The ones at the nest entrance that are fanning their wings either push air out of the nest or pull air into the nest. So this combination of water droplets sprinkled around the nest that are evaporating and bees fanning results in a cooling and air conditioning of the nest, so they're able to bring that temperature down. And when would they do this? You can imagine, for example, that they would do this in the dead of summer When it's really hot outside, that temperature exceeds optimum brood rearing conditions, so the bees need to bring that temperature down so that the brood developing in the nest doesn't die. Adult bees themselves can only survive for a short period of time at temperatures above 45 degrees Celsius, which is about 113 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, I've talked to beekeepers who live in climates that are much hotter than this, and they'll rightly point out to me, wait, our bees are foraging just fine, and it's 120 degrees Fahrenheit. Plus, outside. Well, that's true, but inside the nest where they started their flight is the optimum temperature that they've been maintaining before they go on their flight. And when temperatures get too hot, they can shut foraging down altogether. When it's especially hot outside, and you'll see this a lot in summer evenings, bees will physically vacate the nest. You might see large clusters of bees underneath the entrance of the nest. We call this behavior bearding. It looks like the colony has a beard. And what the bees are doing is they're physically removing their bodies from that nest so as not to generate more heat that would ultimately raise the nest temperature. So bees really need that ability to cool their hive, especially when temperatures begin to go over 30 degrees Celsius, which is about 86 degrees Fahrenheit. Again, that's lower than the brood rearing temperature, but their, quote, mindset, as it were, starts shifting to cooling the nest when it exceeds those temperatures. How do bees do this? How do they have the ability to heat and cool? Well, when we try to heat and cool our homes, we flip a switch on a thermostat which cuts on the air conditioner or cuts on the heater. And the air conditioner and the heater, they are powered by fuel. It might be electricity, it might be propane or natural gas, it might be physically burning logs, but it takes fuel to generate the energy necessary to heat and cool our homes. Well, the same is true for honeybees. The reason honeybees collect and store honey is to have that energy, that fuel needed to do everything that they do when that nectar or that honey is not otherwise available in the environment. So bees generating heat have a high demand for honey. Bees doing the activity of collecting water or fanning their wings, they have a high demand for honey. Honey is the fuel that powers bee thermoregulation. The Western honeybee is a remarkable creature. This thing lives in cavities, has optimum survival temperatures necessary for that colony to function, to produce brood, to swarm, etc., and they are able to control those temperatures in spite of the environmental conditions that they face. In many ways, the honeybee colony is a warm-blooded organism. The individual bees are cold-blooded. Yes, they're insects. But when they come together, they create a beast, the colony, that is able to regulate its temperature against the environmental temperatures. It does what you and I do. It's a remarkable creature that through this amazing ability to thermoregulate has allowed it to conquer so many different environments all around the world.